Hello and good morning, and welcome to another episode of the Morning Metro, April 24th, 2017. We, of course, your hosts, Gertron21 and Gertron. Hello, Gertron, how are you?
I'm doing great. It's been a rather entertaining week and weekend.
Really?
But happy to be on the show today.
Yeah, I was just telling Gertron just a little bit before the show that I was up till like literally 4 in the morning writing the show because for whatever reason, I did not get a chance to write the show like I needed to. So I'm tired, but that's okay. So we're just gonna go ahead and jump into the show. And as usual, I like to start with the weather. I'm actually gonna go ahead and pause this music, and I need to just actually put that in recording instead. So I'm gonna go ahead and flip over here. So today's just generic weather report. Today we're gonna be seeing temperatures in the 50s across most of the United States, with 71 in Denver and 77 in Oklahoma, with Washington experiencing 55 degree weather and possible rain, it looks like. Tonight's forecasts, we're looking at down to the 30s in Reno, which is, that's pretty cold. Like, goodness, we're like, what is it still? We're in spring and we're getting that kind of temperature? That's nuts. Washington gonna be experiencing 52 degrees with possible rain, with mid-Atlantic experiencing, especially in Oklahoma City, 61 degrees for a low. So if you guys are in those areas, just, you know, either stay warm or stay cool, depending on which part of the country. I mean, this weather is just, it's mind-blowing, honestly. Like, yep. I've been, like, watching, especially where I live, it's like one day we had a week where it was, like, in the 80s, right? Mm-hmm. Hot as anything. And then we had days where, like, it was in, I don't know, the 60s. Yesterday was cold. It was in the 50s. I was, like, weed whacking the lawn, and I was cold.
Wow.
I was surprised I didn't get, like, a cold or something, because it was, like, I had to weed whack the lawn, but I didn't want to, like, have a flannel shirt on. But then it was, like, and then it was cold. I'm like, fine, I'll just wear a hoodie. So I basically just wore a hoodie weed whacking the lawn yesterday, but it was definitely, like, in the 50s. I thought there was a giant storm was supposed to be coming. It was, like, down in, like, Kentucky area and stuff. It was ridiculous.
Wow.
So, but yeah, that's the weather report for today. Very hot.
No,
sorry. What? Go ahead. What?
Now, I live in Missouri, and we can literally have all four seasons in the same day. I remember.
Really?
It happens all the time.
Wow.
It'd start out in the morning, all nice and warm, and then we'd have rain, then we'd have snow, and then it'd be back to warm again.
Oh, gosh, dude.
So it that has happened a couple times. Missouri's crazy.
I remember somebody told me, actually, they had like a day where it was really warm, and all of a sudden the next day was snowing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's an insane extreme. Mm-hmm. Like, that's just nuts. And I'd like to also say, actually, from a quick back end, you guys might notice I'm actually using my laptop today on the show, and Gertrude, I don't know if I told you what I did here, but I'm actually doing a screen capture off my laptop into my desktop. I got a capture card recently because I got sick of fighting with OBS. So today's article presentation will be a lot better than it has in the past. So we'll see how this goes today. So if you guys see me looking down, it's because I'm actually reading off my laptop today too. So, but yeah, we're going to go ahead and jump into some articles. And Gertrude, would you please go ahead and take this first article?
Okay, so first off, funny story. It's regarding a 7-year-old who got a totally legit school note that says the kids should play more video games.
That's have this article, by the way, guys. So Gertrude just, like, totally did not give me the link for this one, but that's okay.
I can actually post that
in the chat.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
I went ahead and I put that on that one. That one. There you go.
But you have perms to dump stuff in the chat, you know. You don't have to, like, send me on TeamSpeak. But yeah, okay.
Oh, well, that works too.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, that would be. All right, since I don't have this article, I'm going to go back to our regular screen. So yeah, go ahead and talk about this if you would.
Okay.
Or continue,
so
rather.
So basically, here's what the note says. Dear parents, Nathan has been doing good in all his classes except for video games class.
Video
if
games
he does
class?
Not stay up all night playing video games, he will get kicked out of school.
This is
start
a legit
letting
note?
Him stay up all night and start tonight. He can play anything, computers, Wii, iPads, iPods, phones, or any other electronic.
This was a legit note that he got.
Well, if you can pull the link into the page, you can clearly see it's a kid. It's
oh kids my writing. Gosh. Okay. Wow. Really? From the school?
Yep.
That looks so official. I am. My. Okay.
And according to the parents, she said he got to stay up half an hour late to study for video game class.
Wow. Okay. Nice try, kid. I like your touch. Okay.
It works great.
Okay, kid. So remember, when you want to study for video game class, stay up all night playing video games. I mean, what? Do you go to video game high school? I mean, really?
Now, if you go to a video game college, I mean, they do actually have classes specifically for video games. So.
That's true. I mean, there are colleges that do have scholarships for video games. I think some of them have, like, what, League of Legends scholarships, too, I think? You do that kind of thing?
I see.
You're trying to research into research, man.
Oh, League of Legends school? Wait, what?
Ooh. Wow. I was not expecting that one, actually.
That looks more like it made. Yeah.
User disconnected from your channel.
I don't know about scholarship. Let me look at sound mute. Scholarships.
I forgot to mute myself when you let me speak. That's great. Well, anyway, yeah.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah.
At least 5 colleges now have League of Legends esports scholarships.
Wow. Okay.
That's unique.
That is unique. Yeah, definitely. But yeah. Okay then. So nice try, kid. 10 out of 10.
Exactly.
Now I didn't actually read this one. I skimmed it. It looks tasty. Could you go ahead and talk about it? This is the 100-pound Easter egg thing you posted in the doc last night.
Yes.
Unless did you forget about that or something?
Just a little.
Did you forget to open the link?
I'm a little off on this one today.
Okay, it's all right. It's a Monday.
Minnesota
we're allowed.
Minnesota eatery creates a 100-pound chocolate egg for Easter.
Oh my gosh!
Wow.
100 pounds of dude. Like
that's a lot of chocolate.
That's a heck of a lot of chocolate. Yeah. Holy cow. I mean. Oh my god, that's just like...
It looks like it took them 3 days to finish the egg, which features 8 layers of white chocolate and bears 240 chocolate flowers attached to its outside. It looks like, that makes sense. The egg was made into 2 halves and then fused together, leading Marty to create a dark chocolate border to hide the seam.
Oh my gosh.
If you like chocolate...
Yeah.
If you love chocolate, actually.
You have to have, like, you have to be, like, in a relationship with chocolate, honestly, to eat this. I mean, like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's definitely different. Yep.
Exactly.
Alrighty.
Oh, boy. That's a lot of chocolate. Too much chocolate.
I mean,
if you ask me.
Like, I'll be honest. I like Three Musketeers. I love it. It tastes really great. It's one of my favorite, like, chocolate things. I like white chocolate. But, I mean, that is, like, don't give a 6-year-old that, because that's going to be a sugar rush for days. I mean...
If they can finish that in one day, they're probably going to have diabetes later.
Well, like, my question is, hello and welcome. I see Mr. What M1, I guess is your name, or actually I'll just call you Fox. Good morning, Fox. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, Fox.
I love chocolate, but like that's just oh my gosh. Okay, I don't have any comment about this. We're moving on. We're moving
sounds like
on.
A good idea.
Okay. So this is cool, actually. And Gertrude, I inserted something in your notes here, by the way.
Yes.
But yes, Star Wars Battlefront's first trailer leaks. I was actually, it's funny enough, I was actually using the trailer as test audio actually for this. Let me see if I actually, did I get this to work today? Hold on, let me see if I get this to work. Oh no. There we go. Yeah. But yeah, it looks like that the new Star Wars Battlefront 2 trailer has been released. Gertrude, you want to talk a little bit about this? Since you and I've actually played this together, do you want to chat about it here?
Yeah, well, you and I have played plenty of Battlefront 1.
So fun.
The newest one. Obviously, we're not talking about the older versions. And hello, roofies. And, yeah. I think that's inappropriate.
But anyway.
Now, Battlefront 1 was okay. They didn't have any single-player missions, which was kind of sad.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
their
that was definitely a downfall.
Their community has kind of dropped out some.
Yeah.
But one of the reasons for all that is they released it far too early.
Yeah, and that's... Sorry, go ahead and finish what you're going
to
say there.
Supposedly, Battlefront 2 is supposed to be the makeup for Battlefront 1. They're going to have a single-player mission, and supposedly it's going to go throughout all the eras from Episode 1 all the way till now. So it looks like we'll be able to play it as Darth Maul and probably... just all the different characters and all the different troop types. I think it's going to be awesome,
mm-hmm.
in my opinion. And I hope that when it comes out, it keeps people entertained. And
yeah,
I'm definitely going to be getting this one.
Now, let's talk about this here for a sec. Okay, so... I'm going to call it the... I guess what came out, in 2015? So the Battlefront 2015... So I'm going to call it just for the sake of understanding here, because I know there's been multiple Battlefronts released. I think EA should be kind of ashamed of themselves, honestly, up to this point. Because they hyped the new Battlefront 2015 for a long, long time. Everybody got really, really excited, including myself, because I love Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
And they release it, and the beta was super fun. Like, I've never had so much fun playing an FPS game in my life, nor was I ever really as good as an FPS game as I was in the beta. And then it released, and everybody realized that there wasn't any single-player campaign or anything, and then the community just died out. They didn't offer content fast enough. I think there was reports of it being, like, somewhat glitchy. There were other kinds of annoying, you know, bugs and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And up to this point, I'm kind of sitting here, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I understand you're trying to redeem yourself, but I think it's a little bit too late to be trying to get back to the top now. You know, but I can understand if they want to, you know, if they feel like they still have got the steam under them. But the question is the community for the game still there that it's going to matter? You know, is this new game going to have any kind of impact on the community? Is it going to bring back any players that were there for the original 2015 release? Yeah. What do you think? Should we have our hopes up, or should we just kind of wait till this comes out?
Well, I kind of think we are still going to have that community there because, you know, it's Star Wars. I mean, come on, it's right now, it's a big deal.
Right, so, but EA doesn't have that best reputation, though.
Yeah, well, being that they are clearly stating there will be a single-player mission, which was one of the downfalls for the first one, and the idea that they're going to be able to play through all the eras, well, there's another one.
Yeah.
I think they're trying to bring it, minus graphics and actual mechanics of the game, they're trying to bring it closer to the original Battlefront games, which the original Battlefront games were amazing, in my opinion.
Yeah.
And supposedly, from what I've heard, they're actually going to be bringing in space-to-ground battles, so you might start out on the ground and then go into the atmosphere and be fighting up in space, or you start up out in space and you can make your way down to the ground at the same time.
Yeah. I mean, EA is going to have to really do a lot to get this to come back on top as an interest. Because, you know, it was just such a disappointment when it was released.
It was a disappointment, but, you know, I'm definitely going to be taking a look at it, and there are going to be others that are going to want to at least take a look at it as well. Now, do I believe that their sales right off the bat are going to be really huge?
Probably not.
They gypped us out on the first one, but once people start seeing it, and if it does actually live up to what we're all hoping for, then their sales may increase. They'll bring back some of those faithful Star Wars fans. But hello, Mr. Stavaro.
Good morning.
Good morning.
But yeah, so I mean, I would like to see this be the game that gets EA, the respect or attention it should deserve. I definitely do like Star Wars. I also like Star Trek. Star Trek games I haven't been as impressed with, honestly. There really has been a lot of them that have been a big disappointment. I would like to see this new Star Wars Battlefront 2, I'm going to call it the 2017 release, be really, really good. Because EA's got a lot to make up for, in all honesty, on this one. So if they can do it, great. Let's talk about some of the character designs, actually, as far as some of the rendering. I mean, I know these are kind of like early renders and peaks and stuff. Now, it's kind of hard to see a little bit from the image, but what do you think of some of the character models? Do you think that it will look really good when it's like released, as far as it's like its modeling stuff? I mean, I like what I see.
Yeah.
It kind of looks like they took some of the scenes from like almost the looks like a screen cap almost actually from the movies, not actually from the game. Or is that just how it looks on screen here?
I think that's just how it looks on screen. And when you look when you think about it, the way graphic technology has been progressing over the last, even within the last 5 years, video games now are becoming more and more realistic looking, which is awesome.
Yeah.
But that at the same time means that the system requirements are getting more and more demanding.
Yes.
So
now that we're talking about a little bit more some hardware stuff, what do you think? Let's take a guess. And not confirm, but let's take a guess. What do you think the hardware is going to be needed to run this? Minimum and maximum hardware. I'm thinking maybe like a 980 or a 10, like a 1070, 1080 maybe. What do you think?
Let me take a look here. Personally, I think my video card, I currently have a 960 with 4 gigs of video memory. I think mine will be able to run it. I don't think any of the really old video cards will be able to. I think you'll need a minimum of 2 gigs of video memory, I would imagine. And as far as a processor goes, you're going
to
need more of a quad-core processor. Obviously, it's got to be a quad core.
Yeah, because a lot of games are going quad core 64-bit, actually. Mm-hmm. And it's probably, I'm going to take a guess, it might be code around like DX12, probably, because DX12 is a lot more, there's more polygons in the render models and stuff. So I'm thinking maybe DX12 and maybe Vulkan, because I know Vulkan's the newest API that's been, it's been trying to make its headway into some video games. I know that NVIDIA's been integrating the Vulkan architecture into the newest drivers and stuff, but that's my guess. I would say maybe like a Ryzen 5 for AMD, and maybe like an i5 6th gen quad core processor, maybe at best, for maybe like the minimum.
Possibly. Now, I found on this website, I'm not sure if they're actually referring to Battlefront the 2015 or the 2017. Maybe you can take a look at this right quick. Tell me what you think.
Let me pull up this.
The image that they have, that they used, is clearly from the original Battlefront from 2015, but they're talking about 2017 in the notes. And as far as that goes, it looks like, as far as predicted requirements.
Yeah, I'm having a little trouble trying to find any here, but at least we're, just trying to speculate a little bit here, so people know maybe what to expect. I don't see the. I'd have to see system requirements. See
what we got here. Your page and the page I have.
Two different things.
Nope, that's the same. I'm looking on that same page right there. Right below are the system requirements right there. That they're predicting, I would say.
Yeah,
From what
Battlefront
it
2 says
seems
requiring.
like.
Oh, okay, yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, so okay, so I wasn't too far off on the guessing, actually. So that's actually pretty good. Okay, so a nine, they're predicting like a 970 down to like a GTX 660. And surprisingly, a lot of and hello Schaefer, by the way. Good morning.
Good morning.
A lot of I've been noticing lately, a lot of Steam games are still a 660 is still listed as the minimum requirement, which says a lot about that particular hardware. That's actually pretty impressive that that's like still considered a feasible piece of hardware. Now I know for a fact that a 660 will not be able to do 1080p or 1440 because of its, you know, its age and architecture is definitely starting to show its age up to this point. But maybe 720p gaming. Although who does 720p gaming in 2017? I mean, really? I mean, we're up to like 1080, 4K, to, you know, 8K at some point. So I don't know. It'd be interesting to see, really just overall how this comes out with when it's released and stuff. I don't know if there was a estimated release date here. Let me go scroll through this page.
Sometime
Take
in
some time here.
2017, which is good because 2017 is just getting started.
Well, I said the Star Wars Celebration was supposed to be released between April 13th through 16th in Orlando. But that doesn't mean that that's just for the Celebration trailer. So I don't know. We'll definitely have to just keep an eye on this and
Oh,
come
here we
back.
go. It looks like Battlefront 2 is going to be out in holiday 2017. So
Which is
I'm
actually
most
timely
likely
to the newest
Christmas.
Star Wars release too, because there's going to be a new
Exactly.
Star Wars movie. So that's actually a good drop right there, timing it with the movie release and the game. That's actually pretty that's an interesting marketing tactic. It gets people
Well,
hype.
as you could see, last year they did the same thing, and that was the reason why when they left in 2015 when they let out Battlefront One, they released that right around when the movie came out.
Oh,
And that
okay.
was one
Oh
of the
yeah, you're
reasons why
right.
that one wasn't done as well. And I read some articles
Because
on
it,
that where.
yep. Sorry, go on. Yeah, but I'm agreeing with you because it was rushed. Yeah, right. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm like, I don't mean to interrupt you today. I'm so sorry about that. I'm like, oh yeah, my brain's working today. I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'll be quiet.
It's no problem. But yeah, basically, that's why the first one, according to some articles I've read, that's why the first one didn't work out so well is because they were rushed. They were told you have to release this on or before the movie's release, and they were put in a time crunch. I'm sure that if they had been given the time they were allowed to give to
Right.
get, then it might have turned out better.
Right. Yeah. And you know, that's the thing that I hate about like companies, and I'm not even just talking about video games. I'm talking about just in general. You know, okay, I understand, you know, I get it. It's marketing hype. I get it. You know, it's just how it works. But, you know, if your product is not meeting a standard that people ex come to expect. You know, there's certain brands that you would you know that you expect to have the quality, there would be really good presentation, holds its value. And you know, how many times have we seen in the video game markets games that were hyped got released and then had bugs out the wazoo?
Oh, you ain't kidding. Let's go back to No Man's Sky on that one.
Oh yeah, and I might add Just Cause 3. I'm still mad about that, by the way. Oh, actually, you know what? A small little rant about Just Cause 3. Avalanche Studios had the nerve to release a video talking about the little Easter eggs in the game when the Easter eggs in the game were known about like 3 or 4 months ago, or at least like right after release, all the Easter eggs were found, and then like almost a year later, the actual YouTube channel for Just Cause 3 releases this video about all the Easter eggs. I'm like, guys, nobody care. First of all, nobody cares. Secondly, you're a little bit behind. And thirdly, fix your game, please. Just Cause 3 is still broken. Like, and actually, I think I heard somewhere it was like coded on like Linux, and they released it to Windows or something. And when they got released to Windows, the memory leaks were insane. And took them, like, I don't know how many patches to get it fixed. And people are still angry.
I know. If you're going to release a game, at least release it already optimized.
Thank yes.
And ready to go.
Yes.
Do some more beta testing if you got to.
Oh, my gosh.
I would rather it take a whole nother year for it to come out and it be made right than it being rushed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I totally agree. It just, oh man, I'm sore about it. I'm sorry. But speaking of new technologies and releasing stuff, I don't know if this is a good segue. MasterCard users, beware. MasterCard is unveiling a new type of card with, get this, a built-in fingerprint scanner.
Oh boy.
I'll read off my notes here. It seems that MasterCard has decided to start using not only chip, which was rolled out similarly in 2016, or which actually similar companies rolled out in 2016 rather, but now you also have to use your fingerprint with a built-in fingerprint scanner. But you will have to, according to Techno Buffalo, an enrollment center. You have to go to enrollment center where their fingerprint will be scanned and assigned to their card. Users will be able to save up to 2 fingerprints, which will be stored as encrypted data on the card's EMV chip. But will this really keep you secure in an online digital world? No.
No.
No. Okay, like, okay, so here's the thing. And I've said this, I don't know how many times, to I don't know how many different people. If a hacker wants it bad enough, they will get it. And the problem is that fingerprints, okay, first of all, you can't rewrite your fingerprint, by the way. And secondly, fingerprints can be spoofed. It's very easy to spoof them.
It's not just that. I know sometimes somebody will give me their credit card to go buy something for them because they don't want to have to go themselves or something like that. Okay. All of a sudden, it's like, well, I can't because it requires your finger. Okay, what happens if you don't have any fingers? I mean, there are those unfortunate people.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
That kind of stuff happens to.
Especially guys who come back from a war zone and had like, ooh, this is not a good idea.
Or they get their fingers burned in some way or... God forbid they get, well, they get some new scar on their finger. All of a sudden, it doesn't want to read. You know how many times when I went to, I was thinking about joining the Navy.
Oh, wow.
And, well, this was many, many years ago. And we had to do the whole fingerprint scanning. They had scanners. It wasn't the whole old ink style. It took forever for their machines to actually get my fingers recognized.
Wow.
I mean, it took forever.
Yeah.
So I'm just like, okay, yeah, you get that set up. If it's your card, you're there trying to use it, like, oop, you got to scan it. It's like, well, it's not taking my finger.
Yeah.
Well, then what do you do then? I mean, you know it's your card. They know it's your card. And the card's just like, nope.
I actually have a funny story. One time my mom and I were out. I was like really, really super young. And my mom and I were out shopping and she had to give, and, you know, sometimes some companies will require that you have your identification, like your license and your credit card. But sometimes they'll ask for your license or identification. And I will never forget the time. My mom has told the story many times, but she hands the lady the card and I blurted out and I said, "But that is my mommy." Oh man. But I mean, like, this is scary. Like, the, you know, it's another thing where just companies are just becoming more invasive with privacy. I mean, what if your card gets stolen? Now the hackers got your fingerprint and your chip. There's so many vulnerable things. It's currently being tested in South Africa, actually. The plan is to extend the trial to Europe and Asia Pacific region in the coming months. A full rollout to the markets is expected later this year, assuming the trial goes well.
Yeah.
I don't even know what to say to this, honestly, other than this is just, ugh.
What's next? You're going to have to give blood just to buy something with your credit card? No, I mean,
Lord,
anything is going to be hacked.
Yeah.
I mean, this is going to be hacked too. Even the new, I got the Discover card and it has the chip in it. That could be hacked if somebody really wants to. I mean,
credit card security is just, I mean, well, credit card security and then computer security in general is just like it's I mean, what is security nowadays, honestly? I feel like that it's just they're trying to come up with ways to make things more secure. It feels like more they're coming with more ways to be more invasive, in all honesty. So, you know, this is interesting, but this is also really I don't know. And also, I'm sorry guys if I'm drawing a blank right now. My brain is like I have allergies right now, so my brain's just kind of fried at the moment. But yeah, so I'm having trouble trying to think. But I don't know. I don't think this is a good idea. I think MasterCard is crazy, and this is just going to cause problems for people. I mean, better yet. What if the credit card fails to work and you're trying to buy something? Okay. What if the chip in it fails that has your fingerprint on it?
Yeah, that's
I mean,
problem.
What are we going
to
do?
I don't have to go somewhere to get a whole new card and get my fingers rescanned into a card. That takes a lot of time right there. Now, right now, when you get a new card, all you have to do is call into a phone number, verify some information, and they activate the card.
Yeah.
That's pretty simple. If I have to take out an entire day to go to one of these locations that's going to scan your fingerprints, that could be a whole day right there just to get a credit card set up.
Yeah, man. I had to go to the registration office to get my card fixed. You know, I had to rescan my fingerprint and blah, blah. I mean, like, that sounds so funny just saying it like that. Like, yeah. I had to get rescanned.
oh my gosh. God. Yeah, okay. So I don't think this is a terrible idea, but whatever. That's just me. So you have a MasterCard. I feel sorry for you. And I wish you all the luck in the world of dealing with your fingerprint now being on your card. 10 out of 10, guys. So speaking of updates, okay, now this actually has I have a story about this because this actually did happen last night. All right, so last night I was up, this is talking about the Windows 10 Creators update. Last night I was literally up in the morning. I got my laptop out, which I'm using right here, and I got a prompt from Microsoft that there was supposedly, you know, some new updated features were on their way, and it was like, let's take care of some of your privacy stuff or whatever. I'm like, okay, fine, just whatever. So
just
me being the idiot user that I ended up being, somehow, okay, so guys, be aware of this, by the way. So this is sort of a PSA / story. If you get a prompt about the feature updates coming soon and the like adjusting your privacy settings or whatever, just hit like, I think there's an option to hit no thanks. Just hit that. Not that I have nothing against the creators update, because I have seen a preview for it on, there is a YouTube video that talks about it and it looks really cool. But I wasn't ready to put it on this laptop or my, and I haven't even put it on my desktop, but I accidentally installed the creators update on my laptop. So it is on here right now. I was thinking about doing like a live demo actually of it a little bit on the show. Gershon, do you think that's something I had to do on the show today? Or are you just going to sit there laughing at me?
I'm going to sit here laughing at you. And if you feel the desire to share anything about Windows 10, you go right on ahead. I'm sticking with Windows 7.
Well,
I'm sorry.
I mean, at some point, Windows 7 is going to like not have its support. They're actually already talking about dropping security updates for Windows 8.
Windows 7, their support is supposed to be ending on in 2020. But even when that comes in, I know enough about computers. I'll keep it secured myself.
Let me go ahead and bring up the settings menu here, and I'll talk about this sort of from a firsthand perspective. Well, before I do that, let's check this out. Basically, the Action Center has changed, which is actually very true. The Action Center does look different, as you guys can see on the screen here. There's actually a couple different modes. One of my like is there's like a nightlight mode, so it actually will take out some of the blue light in your screen for late night when you're using your computer and such. There's also they added like 3D. There's like a 3D modeling software. It's sort of a basic one, but it's coded into the OS now, which I thought was kind of interesting. They've added this gaming mode, which of course I don't have any games on here because laptop's not powerful enough to do that. Now, if this doesn't sound biased toward, or not biased, I would say if this doesn't sound like a marketing stunt, I don't know what is. So Microsoft has included a gaming mode, okay, which is supposed to help optimize games that are 32-bit, I might add, because who codes in 32-bit, right?
Yeah.
Code in 32-bit only from the Windows Store, okay? Now, I don't know about you, but they're trying to get you to get games from the Windows Store, not from Steam, not from EA's launcher, from Windows. Yeah. And I think that's retarded. And that is stupid. That is seriously stupid. Like, what's the point? Like, if it's only for one particular market of a game, that is like, that doesn't help somebody like me who uses Steam like literally every day, you know? So they can like optimize the game and draw more resources for the game. There's a whole bunch of other bullcrap stuff in here that I just don't understand what the point of it is. I hate to bash this, but I have to.
Go ahead and bash it. It's Windows 10.
I mean, like, this is the only update that I think is stupid. Now, what I do think is cool is that later, I can't confirm this because it was only speculation. There's been talk that Windows 10 might get a UI update. They're thinking about changing the user interface, which I think is about time. Like, it's really, it's cool that it's recognizable. You know, somebody opens it and it looks like Windows, but I mean, a UI change, that sounds kind of cool. Like, customize your user interface, that'd be nice. So that's the game mode on there. And then there's this, now I'm a legacy user, so I don't like this. There, you can now do the apps and features uninstall right inside the settings menu, but I still use the Windows 7 control uninstall option because it's easier and I understand it. I kind of wish Microsoft would decide which UI they want people to use, because they're flipping between the control panel and the settings menu, which is really confusing because the control panel is also still a settings menu. But the irony is that the control panel shortcuts to the settings menu, which is a whole other UI altogether.
And that's why I have my own uninstaller that takes care of all that for me.
Yeah. So there's that. They changed somewhere in here is the security center. I don't know exactly. Oh, yeah. The Windows Defender has its own security center now, which I like. I think that's cool. I mean, you can take care of all the virus threat, device performance, etc. Again, if you're not a stupid person, please don't download anything you're not supposed to download. Just common sense and you won't have any issues. Sorry, just saying.
Makes sense.
I don't mean to sound so critical, but I'm just saying that's my opinion on that. But those are just some of the changes that I haven't really had a chance to play with it. Now, a couple things. For those of you who are, you know, personal hackers like me who like to hack their own computer, there is a registry key you can enter to actually keep the old legacy volume control. I actually had to re-enter it into this laptop today because I discovered that it got, because the OS wrote a new like registry code or whatever into it, I actually had to rehack my registry again and had to also use that that spybot tool that you sent me not too long ago. Yep. I had to reuse that today. But those are only like little quirks that I didn't like. But otherwise, I mean, it's just mainly some of it is for UI changes. Like, you know, there's themes in Windows Store. Probably have to make you pay for it, I'm sure. The people bar, I have no idea what this is. I only know like some of this stuff. So people integration into Windows 10 taskbar, but this is extends into little widgets that let you quickly send Skype or emails to your favorite friends. Be able to switch between Skype and email. Who uses Skype? Like, it's 2017. Who uses Skype?
Skype. Never.
Within the same window.
I just saw here. Yeah, you can pay for themes. Why would you want to pay for a theme?
Because I don't know.
Life, logic, and girls.
There you go. Full pen support. Okay, now the only reason why I think this is cool is because I actually do have a computer over here. It's an HP something or other. Has a Wacom touchpad with a pen. This will have more pen support, which I think is kind of nice. And especially I'm more interested in this update for the 3D modeling application and for the Windows Defender update. That is really the only reason why I'm actually interested in this particular one. Now the release date, I'm a little bit confused because on my desktop it says that the update is av- available, but it hasn't actually been like pushed to a lot of computers. So at some point I'm probably gonna have to like maybe I guess I'll test it on this laptop, and if I like it, I'll go ahead and just push it to the push it to the desktop and stuff. But that is the new update that is either out or coming out. So if you have Windows 10, if you want to try it, it's available to try. It's build number 1703, I believe. I can actually double check that when VAR here. 1703. I was right. Wow, I'm good at memorizing build updates. So 1703 update is the Windows 10 creators update. I suppose to say creators update. Here's the thing: a lot of content creators are not using applications from Microsoft. They're using applications from like for example, I use a Vegas Pro 14, which is now owned by Magix, or I would use like Persona Studio 1 2 for music creation, or Maya 2014. Although I don't actually own Maya, I only have the student license, which is like good for like 3 years, by the way. So a lot of professional content creators are not really going to be using stuff from Microsoft. They're going to be using stuff from the industry standards. Yep. And I'm wondering if Microsoft realizes this, and therefore they're trying to get a hold in the industry standard or the professional market. I don't know. What do you think about this, Gertrude? Do you think Microsoft is just trying to get in somewhere that they don't really fit, or are they actually really filling a need, or
they just want more money? That's it. That's all. They want more money. That's it. That's all. More money. It's all about the money.
Always
they
about
they
the
want
money.
Their hand in every single cookie jar, even if they don't belong there.
Oh my gosh. I mean, yeah. I mean, like, I like Microsoft only just because I've just been a long time Microsoft user. You know, you're talking about like Microsoft Office. I actually have Microsoft Office 2017. I memorize my softwares way too much. I'm way too good at this. But like, you know, Microsoft Office 2007. I've used that for school stuff. I've been on Windows since like 95, and remember all the like the funny bug issues and the corrupted driver stuff, and then XP. Oh my gosh, XP was a fun day.
Yep.
Back when we didn't have a unified DLL system, and everybody was writing their own driver and their own library for it to work in one like clash or the other and stuff. Like any company, you know, they're gonna have to reinvent themselves to some degree. They're gonna have to keep innovating because they gotta stay on top of the market. You know, so it's to be expected they're doing something new. Whether how successful it is, it depends on the people that are, you know, depends on the users. You know, and the what frustrates me a little bit right now as a Microsoft user, or a Windows user rather, is that people, you know, I know that updates are important. Okay. Let's just cover the basis of the fact that no matter what OS you're on, updates are important. Okay. You need it for security, you need them for optimizations, whether you're talking about Apple or Windows, right? So they're important. Now, what's bugged me about this is that people that are on Windows 10 will gripe and complain that they're getting updates. But then they gripe and complain on the flip side that their computers are getting hacked, or they're getting viruses. Or back when I had my IT job, we're asking people, you know, did you update your computer? And they look at you like, what? You know, so, okay, for anybody watching this, you cannot have it both ways. You either want to be protected or you don't. Okay? So don't complain that you're getting updates when you're already complaining as it is that you're not getting updates. Okay? There's this ridiculous idiocy in the consumer market right now where people just can't figure out which one they want. And the reason why Microsoft enabled the ability for Windows to auto-update was that because Microsoft knows that not all of its users are very intelligent. Therefore, they auto-pushed updates.
Sorry. Now, I mean, I still want control of my updates.
Yeah,
Now,
actually, small side note on Gertrude, you might want to keep this in mind when you do IT stuff. Windows 10 Pro actually has more control over updates than Windows 10 Home.
Yes.
Which I really don't quite understand why that is.
Well, I could give you an idea on that.
Go for it.
Recently, we had somebody bring in their Windows 10 computer stating it was not working at all. There was some sort of issue with it. Uh-huh. And we found out that it was an update that was trying to be pushed by Microsoft. That completely, yeah, messed the computer up. After we did some research into it, we found that we not only had to reinstall the operating system, because the update that Microsoft pushed out messed with the system settings, which just kaput it. But very quickly, Microsoft sent out an update following that to fix that. Some people were able to get it fixed. Some people had to reinstall their operating system. That's one thing that I do not like about having forced updates, is because sometimes Microsoft does make mistakes. Though they are very powerful, they do make mistakes.
Now, let's talk about this. I mean, just from a, just from, you know, sort of a coding basis. And now, granted, I don't know code. I've only studied just a little tiny bit of Python. Don't know that much about it. But is Microsoft, do they have bad OS coders? I mean, do you think...
They might. I do know that how they kind of handle it is when they make a new update, they push it out to their beta testers first, make sure it runs on those.
Yeah, if you're
on
the insiders program,
push it out to everybody. What they don't take into account is that, well, not everybody's going to be able to take the update. While in most cases, yeah, Microsoft can send out updates and they'll be just fine. Mm-hmm. But there are those off chances. Like, back when I did have Windows 10 on my laptop, which I don't have that laptop anymore.
Mm-hmm.
This was first when Windows came out, when Windows 10 came out.
Mm-hmm.
I remember my computer just turning on randomly in the middle of the night because it wanted to do updates. And I was just like, wait, what?
Really?
In the middle of the night, I see this bright light coming from my computer. I'm like, what are you doing?
Wait, the computer was completely powered off and it powered on?
I had it in sleep mode.
Oh.
Not normally, but...
Oh, yeah, because it has a wake timers thing. Yeah, okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Which,
yeah.
Which was annoying as all get out. And then, yeah. Yeah, that was it with me in Windows 10. I'm just like, nope.
Oh, gosh.
Nope.
Well, go ahead and finish your little rant there.
Well, it's because when I went in there, I had set it not to start at 3 a.m. in the morning, because by default, Microsoft likes to do all their updates around 3 a.m. in the morning because they figure nobody's going to be up.
Yeah, makes sense.
I went in there and I tried to stop it from doing anything at all. I don't want them.
Oh, gosh.
Nope.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and here's the thing for me as actually a content creator, both on Twitch and YouTube. Updates are... I can't afford a lot of downtime.
Yeah.
Especially the fact since I use my desktop quite heavily, literally every day, or anything from streaming to studying stuff online.
Mm-hmm.
So downtime, although my computer is not that slow, is not helpful. And sometimes, depending on the computer, you know, somebody's downtime could literally mean their job, you know. But I understand, you know, 3 a.m., yeah, on an update Tuesday, sure, 3 a.m. makes sense, but I don't know. But actually, go ahead and now talking about the opposite of Microsoft, Apple is actually considering to buying into Toshiba's multi-billion-dollar investment into Toshiba chip units. I'm actually going to go ahead and read off my notes here. So basically, where is it here? According to Fox News, Apple's looking to Toshiba to provide chips for Apple products. So basically, Apple wants to invest more than 20% in Toshiba's chip business while convincing Toshiba to maintain a partial stake to keep the business under the U.S. and Japanese control to allay the Japanese government's concerns, the report said. Apple's considering a plan in which Taiwan's Foxconn would also own a stake of around 30% in its bid, it added. So basically, Apple is going to be, let's see, where is it here? Toshiba is now in the process of selling its memory chip units to raise cash to cover write-downs at U.S. nuclear unit, Westinghouse, that have plunged into crisis. Well, basically, what I'm trying to say is that Apple wants to invest in some of Toshiba's technologies. It sounds like they want to, get into some of Toshiba's manufacturing processes and stuff. Now, it doesn't sound like they would want to buy out Toshiba, but as we all know, and actually this next article kind of talks about this too, so sort of half segueing into this. Apple is not doing so hot in the laptop market right now.
Yep.
It's been, and good morning, Castlemania. How are you, sir?
Good morning.
Well, actually, more like good afternoon, because we're kind of going to the, well, for you, it's morning. For me, it's now starting the afternoon time, but still, hello, either way. Apple's losing its hold, honestly, I've been hearing. Their laptop sales are plunging. They haven't refreshed any of their product line. They're investing more in their mobile stuff, or not even refreshing stuff at all. All of the internet. Gertron, please, I'm talking too much. What do you think?
Well, I mean, let's take a look here. You go out there and spend roughly $1,000, $2,000 on an Apple machine, and you could spend that same amount of money and get a desktop PC machines for almost twice the power, if not more.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's just like it's a money thing. Apple's just has all their stuff way too overpriced.
Oh man.
But that's because they have complete control over it.
Their Apple computers are glamour machines. Let's be honest, they're glamour machines. And actually, let's go ahead and actually go into this next article right with it. And as we just talked about here, Apple tumbles down laptop brand survey after a tepid reaction to the new MacBooks. And I actually wrote some of my show notes here, so let me go ahead and read off of this a little bit. Fox News was recorded as saying, if you're... Oh, wait. Where is it? Oh, there we go. I was wrong place. I was in my wrong thing. Apple may be losing its King of the Hill spot in laptops. According to FoxNews.com, there was a survey done by the Laptop Mag. Apple has lost its top spot and being taken over by Lenovo, followed by Asus and Dell.
Wow.
So that's pretty interesting. I'd buy a booster board before a MacBook. I agree with you wholeheartedly, Castlemania, definitely. So basically, because Apple has not, as we said, innovative anything new. I mean, the most that they added was just that stupid little slider bar on their MacBooks. That was the only thing they've added that I know of as of recent. So, I mean, to me, that really just says that they're running out of ideas. And honestly, Apple has not been the same since the late Steve Jobs died. Let's be honest.
Yeah.
Steve Jobs, he was Apple. Like, I think, honestly, Apple died with Steve Jobs. I'll just say it right here, right now. Which is kind of a shame because, not that I'm saying I like Apple. I ironically have an iPhone 4 sitting here on my desk that I reuse. I don't even use that often anymore, honestly. And thank you, Castlemania, also for the host right there, too. Apple is just not innovating enough, and also said that HP managed to sneak in above Apple at the number four. Well, Acer actually tied with Apple for fifth. Apple beat Acer in five of the six criteria, but Acer crushed Apple when it came to value and selection. I hate Acer. I've never enjoyed working on Acer laptops. Unless it's just because I was working with the older ones, I've never enjoyed Acer, honestly. I'm really surprised about that. That says a lot right there, honestly, for Acer to be in the fifth spot with Apple. That's kind of hilarious, too, because it kind of proves my point. So, Gertron, tell me, do you think we're seeing... Do you think that Apple is going to just keep slipping out of the market? Are we going to see Apple drop off completely? I mean...
I don't foresee Apple dropping off ever completely, but I do believe it's going to continue to slip again because they really aren't making any much changes. It's been the same thing
Oh my gosh, yes.
For like ages. Yeah. So it's just, and also their price point. A lot of people, a Mac is designed for a specific set of people. Mm-hmm. Mainly those who work with media creations and things of that nature. Your average user is not really going to be using a Mac if they're just doing regular internet searching and maybe some light gaming. Because let's face it, on most Macs, you're not going to do a whole bunch of gaming.
Uh-huh.
Just in general.
Apple's never been geared toward gaming, honestly.
Exactly. And let's just face it, this is the gaming generation.
It is, yes, yeah.
And that falls into the realm of the PCs.
Yeah.
And the cost point, again, would have to throw that in there as well.
And college kids want to look cool.
Spend $2,000 on a computer, on a Mac, that you can go out and buy a PC that's, again, double if not triple the power.
You know, and the thing about that is that, you know, for that same $2,000, you could also spend for like a high-end video camera to be a content creator too.
Yeah.
Now, what I would like to actually kind of fire back on when you were saying about the about Apple being used for media creation, I think that Windows is actually they're really getting, you know, more users are on Windows for content creation than they are Apple. Mm-hmm. And I think even I wish I didn't feel so fogged at the moment. I'm so sorry. I think with you know, things like with people just doing what they are with you know, PCs, you look at more people are streaming on PC, more people are gaming on Windows, more people are, mm-hmm. you know, Windows is actually really getting, is really taking over, I think, the computer market more so than Apple is. And I've kind of always hated how that, like, I remember one time somebody, I was walking out of church one time or something, and somebody asked me about, we're talking about, I guess, jobs or whatever, like just media, you know, media jobs in general. And mm-hmm. I said something to the effect of that I was trying to save up for, I wanted to get into like media, and they were like, well, why don't you just get an Apple computer? I'm like, what does that have to do with anything? Like, yeah. You can do the same amount of bull crap on a Windows computer than you can on Apple. I don't want to say like bull crap, but you can do the same amount of stuff on one versus the other. You know, so, I mean, just noticed that comment there. You know, so, I mean, it really doesn't matter which platform you're on. You can do the same amount of stuff that you can do on a Mac. And honestly, I'm going to say it, you can do some of the stuff better on a Windows than a Mac.
Yeah.
I mean,
another thing with Macs, you can't really upgrade a Mac. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're stuck with whatever you got. A PC, there's so many options, especially if you got a desktop.
Mm-hmm.
If you get a desktop version Mac, you can't do much to it. But you get a desktop version PC, oh, you can do loads. You can do a whole bunch with the PC than you can with a Mac. You can just, I mean, that's just the case. There is no way I would ever buy a MacBook just to be using on a regular basis. If somebody gave me one, definitely. I'd keep it, but I may end up actually selling it just so I can buy a better PC. Let's take a look here. Grid throwing some shade. He's thirsty. He's grabbing a drink of water right quick.
I'm so sorry, I'm back.
Yeah, no problem. I'm just...
That's better.
Now, the whole idea that Apple computers don't get malware, Macs don't get malware,
this is a good one, yes.
It might not happen as much, but...
It does happen.
It does.
And I've been hearing some reports, actually, that hackers are getting... This is a great segue. This goes right back to what I was talking about earlier. If a hacker wants it bad enough, they'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing is invulnerable now.
Yeah.
You know, so...
I'm just going to put it out there. I mean, if you're just buying a Mac because
it's for
you're show. Like, oh, you're not going to get any viruses on it. And, okay, iOS is just harder to hack. This is true, and that's why many people aren't making as many viruses for Macs is because, number one, yes, it's harder. Mm-hmm. Number two, there is not a huge population in the world that has them. It's so much easier to hit PCs with malware mm-hmm. and to hack PCs, the Windows operating system, than it is for Mac. So which one's going to be easier to get into, and which, how much energy do you really want to put into it?
Right, yeah. I mean, you know, like, I mean, just the other day, actually, this is, I hate to admit this, but this was a mistake on my part. I was actually trying to look up something with a friend of mine over, we were trying to look up some emulator for, like, a Wii U game and stuff. I went to some website, and an ad blocker was like, you know, hey, this could, or I think it was actually Chrome that did this, because I think only Chrome does this, but it was like, you know, hey, this site's unsafe, you might want to, you know, be wary of this. And it's just like, oh, I'm just trying to look something up. Well, actually, I think I might have gotten a small little issue, like a small little, I don't know if it was a virus, just Windows Defender detected something. But I was just like, you know, oh gosh, you know, it just was kind of like a thing of you know, oh snap, I did something stupid, you know. So, and actually there's I have some other stories. This is like a longest episode of the Morning Metro ever, but that's okay. It's a talk show. What's what we do. So my mom one time, I think accidentally yes, Castlemania, I was a bit of an idiot that day. but hey, we all make mistakes, right? Right. We're not invulnerable. No, not at all. so I ended up just, like, you know, infecting my computer. And I know one time my mom's computer had, like, this weird thing. It was actually, like, it was this weird ad virus that was in her computer for, like, the longest time. And when we went to uninstall McAfee, this ad virus thing popped up. We couldn't get rid of it. And it was like, as long as McAfee was on there, it wouldn't show up. So it took us having to actually reinstall Windows 10 for it to finally go away and stuff. So that was an interesting day. But, you know, I mean, I just, and not only that, like, iOS is, you know, there isn't, like, I can open up my phone and have, like, widgets and have cool applications and, you know, stuff like that. So you look at the Android market and how much broader that is. There's a lot of people that are coding for that and stuff. You look at, you know, maybe iOS and stuff, you know, that's, you know, that has some innovative stuff in it slightly, but it's not as innovative as something like Android or Windows. So, you know, Apple's not really, they're not doing so hot, I don't think, on some of this stuff. And to actually go ahead and a little bit of a segue, because I want to ignore this question, Bitcoin currency, is it safe or not? Gertrude, thank you for the link there. I'll actually pull it up on the laptop here. But go ahead and talk about a little bit what you think. Is Bitcoin, first of all, is it feasible? Because I know that actually its value went down not too long ago, mm-hmm. although it was supposed to come up. And secondly, Bitcoins are actually done on computers, which are ironically also hackable. I mean, Gertrude, what do you think? Safe or not?
Well, personally, I would be steering away from, mostly because after just doing a quick read on this article, it looks like Bitcoin does not have the same federal regulations and protection that banks have, and just, well, money in general. So I personally would not be using it, because it seems like here, if somebody scams you out of Bitcoin, there's nothing really you can do about it. You're just out of luck. But if you purchase something with Bitcoin, if they decide they're not going to pay you back, well,
yeah,
you,
I mean,
better get ready to fight for it. While on a lot of other payment options, a lot of other sites and how you can handle it, especially like with PayPal, and you're using real money, I mean, you request a refund and either they pay you back or you go into a fight with them through PayPal. And in most cases, PayPal will let you win your money back.
Well, let's try to connect this all together here, because I like connecting dots. So, all right, I know this. Now, the thing about this is that what's actually very common in Bitcoin currency is the fact that I'm not able to actually pull up the same article that you were to pull up, so I'm gonna actually go ahead and just skip that. Okay, so when I had my IT job, we actually heard of a case where there was a virus going around, or malware going around, where people's computers would actually get locked by the malware, and to unlock it, you had to pay in Bitcoin. And this goes back to saying that, you know, not only on Windows, but again, also Mac, people's computers are getting locked by this. The hackers want, you know, virtual ransomware money. And it all just makes for really bad situation altogether. You know, I mean, you can push out security updates, you can reinvent your laptops, you can do whatever, but I mean, where does this all lead to eventually, right?
Exactly.
So I don't know. I think Apple just really needs to get their stuff together and you know, really need to pull themselves up and give us something actually to grasp on. Otherwise, they're gonna fade off or something, or that their sales are just gonna go down. The company goes down, and somebody's gonna end up acquiring Apple. I think that's just what's gonna end up happening. But yeah, and I don't even know how to say her name, but this is not the show for beatboxing, sir. I'm so sorry. So we're going to ahead and move on to our last and final article. So this actually kind of connects well from the article that we talked about last week or the week before about mechs, but it seems that two companies, one from Japan, one from America, are going to attempt. Looks like there was I think it was at a robotics fair on the West Coast, a mech battle. There's actually a video here. I didn't get a chance to actually play through it, but let me actually go ahead and read through some of this. Fox News was recorded saying, if you're a red-blooded testosterone-popping tech fan who likes your gear served up with thick, crusted slices of pro wrestling, the only the only confederation that matters this year is the one pitting California robotics company Megablocks against Japanese robotics company Tsurubashi. In a total awesome robot duel that's been years in the making. And I also put a note about the video and the website. Tejodi can wrestle. So apparently I kind of skimmed a little bit last night. But I'm going to go ahead and just check out a little bit of this video here. If we can watch some of this. But this looks really super cool, honestly. I don't know if you guys can hear some of that, but let me actually try and scrub through and see if we can watch some of the. Yeah, this looks so. Gersh, I don't know if you got this up on your computer or not, but this looks so amazing. Like, these are like full out like mech warriors right here. Oh, that's cool. Oh, they actually fire actual weapons too. Nice.
That's gonna be epic.
That is gonna be epic. You know, it was funny. We were talking about mechs last week, and we were talking about you know, the fact that we were kind of looking at some of the bad points of it. But I mean, mech battles, like, dude, mech battles.
hey, I love mechs.
Yeah,
and I've played Mech Warrior Online. I would love to see stuff like that actually happening.
Mm-hmm.
I just hope I'm sure they'll have the battle able to be viewed online when that happens. I'm going to be watching that one.
So I'm not sure which robot they're referring to, but as far as Tales of the Tape go, one of the mechs apparently weighs 12 tons instead of 6, and towers in it 16 feet. So instead of the 15, I guess there was some regulation, or whatever that I guess it fell short of or something, or I guess above. But yeah, like, wow, I would love to know. So does that mean they're gonna, like, I'm kind of interested to see what a mech battle would look like. I mean, some thoughts, speculation. What do you think? Mainly because I didn't read the article, so I'm kind of drawing a blank now. I'm really, really sorry. I should have read more into this, but yeah.
I am not sure exactly what that is going to end up being, It doesn't look like they're going to be using real weapons, so I don't think we're going to really have to worry about anybody really dying.
Well,
unless,
yeah,
of course, you
I
know,
mean,
accidents
that,
happen.
That is kind of something to be concerned about. I can see where they, you know, really wouldn't do that and stuff. But yeah, that is like that. That's just this wasn't. Let's see. Our biggest challenge has been supplier systems integration and logistics. Cleveland continued that the MK3 includes about 800,000 worth of off-the-shelf and custom parts that were often ordered in gigantic bulk orders. So supply getting high-quality parts in the door, reliability has been a huge issue for us. Integrating all of those parts into a cohesive system has been really challenging. Yeah, I bet. I mean, my gosh, you know. We have about 3,000 wires on the robot and around 300 hydraulic hoses, 26 of the fastest hydraulic valves in the world, and over 430 horsepower gas engine that wants to be in a car and not a robot. Getting all those to play nice has been a long process. That is crazy.
Yeesh.
Like, I mean, like, dude! Car engine and a robot? What?
Talk about power right there.
That is some serious horsepower right there, dude. But yeah, that is like that's really quite super cool, honestly. So I'm looking forward to seeing when this goes off. Now I'm trying to figure out here, Gershon, maybe you can scan a little bit faster than I can of when this battle will actually occur. Once this happens, I don't think people are going to think of mechs the same way. This may actually be, I mean, could this be like the next, like, you know, forget wrestling. It's now, the new thing is now mech wrestling and stuff. I mean, that's going to be interesting.
Possibility.
I wonder what it's going to be like to pilot one of those things.
Oh.
That sounds like.
A year ago. I'm not entirely sure when it's going to be happening.
Oh, that's a shame. I'm surprised they didn't mention that on the article and stuff. But nice, very very cool. So yeah, but that kind of brings us to a close for our articles for the day. I guess this is where we talk about our personal stories and stuff. But Gertrude, stories. You said you had a crazy week. Do you care to share? If you wanted.
Just a bunch of crazy people I talk to all day. That's about it.
Wow.
Craziness.
Yeah.
But
well, I had a really I mean, if you can't think of anything more, yeah. I have a bit of a story actually.
Okay.
So this past weekend obviously was Easter weekend and everything. We actually our church actually rented out a concert venue area and stuff, and we got to actually run fiber cable throughout the whole place.
Ooh.
Yeah, it was really cool. This particular fiber cable, well, at least one of them, actually would carry, I think, sound, audio, and even power to one of our cameras, actually. And that really... that was really quite cool to just see, you know, to like just run all this like cool cabling all over the place and stuff. I got to actually operate a soundboard for the live stream that our church does and everything. And it was just really cool to like, you know, it was like media overload. It was so fun. We, you know, I got to see like lights being hung up and stuff and like all kinds of just really, really awesome, really, really awesome stuff. So yeah, it was really quite an awesome weekend. I enjoyed like every minute of it and stuff. So I'm kind of sad that's over, but yeah, it was a great weekend. So we took all of Saturday to set up, and then part of Sunday we were supposed to go through the run through of the service and stuff. Never got through it. I might add, the service started. We, you know, did what we thought we were supposed to do and stuff. Everything ran fine, except for the end. We didn't know exactly like what to do because, you know, we hadn't ran through all of the service and stuff. But it still went great, and everybody worked well together. I had a cool bunch of people to work with and stuff. So I enjoyed it. It was good.
Well, you know, at least everything seems to be working out. Computers in general and media stuff, it can always be a chore, especially when you're doing stuff in front of others. Uh-huh. And you have a lot of people counting on you.
But, definitely, yeah. So, but, yeah, I don't know. And you got anything else, or is that all you, I feel bad, because I feel like I did a little talking during the show, and I feel like you didn't get a word in edgewise, so I'm so sorry about that.
It's fine. It's been kind of a hectic, week. I had to get my car fixed, and that was an $800 bill I did not want to have to deal with. But least I have tomorrow off from work, so I'm excited about that.
Nice, nice.
And, have you seen any good movies lately?
Yeah, actually I did. I saw the Case for Christ movie, actually. Yeah. Really good.
I have yet to be able to see that, and the pastor is right now going through an entire series based off of that movie, and I'm still waiting to see it.
Mm-hmm.
I've read the Case for Christ, both the student version and the full version. I've watched the Case for Christ, the documentary, which came out, well, several years ago.
Right.
And all of those were all really good. And this movie seems like it's a really good movie. How it's not the documentary anymore. It's
actual
storyline.
I'll be honest. There were some scenes that just like, they really were like very, emotionally just gripping for me, honestly. And it was really quite cool to have that, to just watch it was just, it was very powerful, very, very powerful. So it was really quite cool to, you know, just, it was well done. It really got the point across. You really could like tell the emotions of the characters and stuff, the actors and actresses and everything. So if you guys haven't seen it, I have a movie recommendation. Go see The Case for Christ. Looks really, really super good. And not only that, what I am excited for actually is for the new Star Wars film coming out in holiday.
Definitely.
Holiday. This can be good.
I cannot wait for that one to come out.
Oh my gosh, yeah. I was watching a trailer for it, and it looked really good, and I was actually watching sort of a speculation type of video, which I thought was kind of interesting. It kind of like cluing into, you know, maybe some possible like, you know, the reform of the Jedi Order and stuff like that, what's her face? Rey being, you know, the one that changes everything, mm-hmm. and stuff. So it definitely looks really, you know, really, really good. I'm very interested to see how this progresses. You know, because obviously we know that George Lucas, for whatever Lord knows reason why, sold the franchise over to Disney. Yeah, I know. Everybody has a price tag. It's kind of ridiculous. I mean, if you got a price tag, you're a cheap person. I'm just gonna say right now.
Yeah, agreed.
But you know, it looked really good. I think it's going to be, you know, another one of those top movies of the year and stuff. And not only that, also too, but the new Pirates film. Looking forward to that. That looks good.
Have you seen it? I kind of gave up on those, to be honest.
Yeah, it's been I saw some of that, and I watched a trailer for it, and after I was done, I was just like, oh man, the story of Jack Sparrow, say what? Like, that's going to be pretty cool. So, but yeah, that's all I've got. You know, I don't know if you've got anything more to add. If not, we'll just, drive this home and, close out the show for today. Anything else, Gertron?
Oh, no, not really. It's been a day.
Right.
That's all I have to say about that one.
Right. Well, thank you guys so much for watching and hanging out, participating in the chat and stuff. We wish you all a very good week. I actually have a small little personal announcement. All of this week, I will actually be taking taking a week off from Twitch, actually. I will not be streaming this week. So, if you guys were hoping to, like, you know, participate, see my game streams and stuff like that, I need to take a break from Twitch and everything. I just need to work on some stuff. So this will be the only, stream of doing just for this, this week and stuff, and then I'll be back all of next week for my usual streams, stuff like that. But until then, thank you guys so much for watching, and yeah, we'll catch you guys, well, I'll see you guys next week, actually, since I'm taking the week off. So yeah, have a good week, guys.
Yep, have yourselves a good week, and we'll talk to you guys later.
All right.